السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين محمد بن عبد الله النبي الصادق الأمين. I pray to Allah سبحانه وتعالى to accept our عبادة، and I pray to Allah سبحانه وتعالى to remove this pandemic from all. My discussion today will be about if a person is patient, when he or she can break his or her fast. And the answer is in the ayah of the Quran al-Kareem, Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah number 183. And the practice of the Sahaba, of course, based on the traditions of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Because this is our source for legislation. This is our source for guidance. We take ahkam shar'iyya from the revelation, especially when it comes to the ibadat. In the transactions, there is room for maybe some other sources, like the ta'aleel and legal cause. But in the ibadat, al-ibadat tawqifiyya, you take it as it had been defined. In the ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم ومن كان منكم ومن كان مريضا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخر يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر ولتكملوا العدة ولتكبروا الله على ما هداكم ولعلكم تشكرون. The month of Ramadan is the month in which the Quran was sent down as a guidance for mankind and with clear signs, containing guidance and the criteria to use or to refer to in your life. Any of you who is resident or who witnessed the month, then let him fast or her fast. But anyone of you who are ill or on a journey traveling should fast another numbers of days later on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes ease for you. He does not desire or describe difficulty for you. So the ayah is very clear that if you are resident, then you should fast. If you are traveling or if you are sick, you are allowed not to fast, but you have to make up the missing days after that. The Sahaba, Ridwanullah ta'ala alayhim, used to travel. Some of them would fast, some of them wouldn't fast, some of them would pray four rak'ahs without reducing the number of the rak'ahs. Some of them would make qasr, salah, because they are traveling. And no one would argue or condemn what the other did. So they have this tolerance. But now, if a person is traveling and he chose not to fast, everyone will jump on his neck or on her neck. Why are you not fasting? It's easy. Just 5 hours flight from Los Angeles to New York, or 1 hour flight from Los Angeles to San Francisco. Why don't you fast? Well, number one, it is rukhsa. It's up to the person to decide. It's not up to me. I cannot decide even on behalf of my son or my daughter or my wife. And she cannot decide on my behalf either. So this is something we experience and we practice based on how do I want to use this rukhsa. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم told us, إن الله يحب أن تؤتى رخصه كما يحب أن تؤتى عزائمه. Allah likes the exemptions to be practiced as well as the original rule, the azima. You have the azima, the original rule, and you have the rukhsa, the exception. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes both to be done. So if someone chooses to use this rukhsa, then that's fine. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. No problem. Let's learn from the Sahaba. who learned from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If someone chooses to carry the azima, then also it's up to him. Some people will say, well, fasting, breaking the fast in a journey is justified by the hardship. No, that's not right. This is not the right understanding for the rukhsa. The ayah did not specify any legal cause at all. Actually, there are some jurists like Ibn Hazm who think that fasting is not acceptable if you are traveling. He went as far as this. I wouldn't disagree with him. I wouldn't agree with him, actually, I should say. I wouldn't agree with him, but, you know, it's just a rukhsa. Now, go back to the first excuse. فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا. If a person is a sick, when this person can break his fast or her fast? We very often hear saying that you are allowed not to fast only if a doctor allows you not to fast and tells you that fasting will be will complicate your case. That's not correct. Actually, you shouldn't fast before the case gets complicated. And in certain diseases, in certain cases, if a person gets sick and keeps fasting, it's possible that his fasting will get complicated. So now with the COVID-19, you don't wait until the situation, until they carry you to the emergency room or until they move you to the ICU. Maybe at that time it's too late. I would say from the very beginning, when you notice the symptoms of the disease and you figure out, yeah, it is disease, you go to make the test to make sure. But by then you are allowed not to fast. Not fasting for the sick person or for the traveler is not associated with any legal cause at all. Now, it's left up to us. But should we use this exception or not? Like I said, it's personal. It depends on the person. If a person thinks that he can make it, then that's fine. وَأَنْ تَصُومُ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. But if not, then this person should not fast without trying to push him to fast. This is an exception given to him. Actually, also there is another point related to this, which is that doctors, the nurses, the medical professionals who are in the front line. You know, I was reading yesterday about a doctor. She ended up finishing her life. She couldn't tolerate handling COVID-19 cases. Always, she cannot go home. She cannot have a rest. The stress on her, at the end, she didn't take it. So some doctors asked me, actually, can we break our fast if we are in this situation in the front line? If you take care of others in the front line, you don't need to reach to that situation where you will break down. This is an exception also for you not to fast to save the lives of others. So the concept behind the ibadah is that we need to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on His instructions, not based on our emotions, not based on what we think that it will be more acceptable. The emotions alone should not define our acts of ibadah. Shouldn't, a period, actually. The emotions are needed for the motivation. It should be the drive. Why do I worship? Inshallah, I worship to acquire the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I want to do this. I'm internalizing this. But how to? Not just based on my inner internalization. Because I will think, okay, I want to make dhikr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very often. So why don't I add this? and that. You know, three people came to in Medina to the wives of the Prophet وسلم, and they asked him, they asked them about the ibadah of the Prophet وسلم. When they were told about it, فَكَأَنَّمَا تَقَالُوهَا, as if they belittled it. So they said Rasulullah is forgiven, so that's why he worships this little. So a person said, from now on I will keep fasting, I will never break my fast any day. And the other person said, I will keep praying the entire night, I will never go to rest any night. And the third person said, I'm going into quote unquote marriage strike, I will not get married, I don't want to be distracted with this dunya. So when Rasulullah knew about this, he said, مَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّتِي فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي, he who turns away from my path that I gave to people doesn't belong to us. This is the path of the Prophet ﷺ. He said, I am conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I have the taqwa more than anyone of you, but I fast and I break my fast, I pray and I sleep and I get married. So the emotions only, okay, I want to worship this much because this is not acceptable, so I don't want to sleep at all, I don't want to break my fast at all, I don't want to get married, I want to keep praying, for two rak'ahs in the fajr is not good enough, you know, let me make them four, that's not allowed. The ibadah should be governed by the hukum shari'i, motivated by our emotions but governed by the hukum shari'i. So in this case, to wrap up the subject, the sick person, the patient, or the traveler, by just being in this situation, medical situation, where he knows or the doctors tell him that you are patient with this disease or with that disease, is it good reason for him or her not to fast? That's why I wonder when some people ask about anesthesia, if a person gets anesthesia before the surgery, does it break his fast or not? I tell them, you don't need to fast. And I wonder why some jurists, some people keep debating, does anesthesia injection, does it break the fast or not? Another person was asking, I was reading about IV, the IV nutrition. A person cannot eat, so they have to feed him or her by the IV. And then they ask, oh, does it break my fast or not? And the ones who are answering it, they start debating, does it break the fast or not? They shouldn't fast. This is the answer which they should be given. If you need this nutrition, if you are carried to the emergency room and they put the IV, you don't need to fast. We hope that you can drink in this case. So we need to realize that our job is not to make it difficult on people or to make it easy on people, because some people say, okay, you know what, you are making it easy on people. I'm not the one who has the authority to make it easy. No one else has the authority to make it easy or to make it difficult. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر. Allah intends and wants the yusr, the good things from you, and the easy things from you, not the tough things. So I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He will give us the ability to fast, to perform the acts of ibadah, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to worship Him the way it should be. If there is any question, please let me know before I conclude, because I'm about to finish the conclusion, inshallah rabbil alameen. So, and the answer for all brothers who said salam, salam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh, barakallah feekum, wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka allahumma natubu ilayk, allahumma ij'al ijtima'ana hadha ijtima'an ma'asuman, wa ij'al tafarruqana ba'dahu tafarruqan marhuma, wa la tada' fina wa la bayinana shaqiyan wa la mahruma, wa al'asri inna al-insana lafi khusr illa alladhina amanu wa 'amilu s-salihati وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن شاء الله رب العالمين. Tomorrow I will address another topic.